Hello and welcome along to another one of our special web chat series here, which is coming to you from Moscow, just outside Red Square, in fact, where they've closed off sections of it in preparation for Russia Day, which kicks off tomorrow. Behind us there are a lot of fans gathering. We've seen much of them starting to file through the city as we've just got 3 days to go now. SBS Chief Football Analyst Craig Foster, certainly very exciting times. But I want to pick up on a blog that you wrote. That's the lead topic of discussion for us today. And it talks about the cycles in which we as a footballing nation have been in.
Yep.
And just give us a brief overview of your argument and the points that you made in that blog.
Yeah, basically what I was explaining is that Australia has a rare luxury because the globe is split into six different confederations, and we're now within the Asian Confederation, where we're clearly one of the strongest. And whilst qualification isn't guaranteed, we're now in our fourth consecutive World Cup. It took us 32 years to get there, and the terror of that can linger for a long time. And if we were, for instance, in South American or European qualifying zones, where regularly many top teams who are currently stronger than us miss out on qualification, it's natural that the boom and bust 4-year World Cup cycle drives almost everything. And it takes a tremendous amount of guts, I think, firstly, foresight and planning to be able to actually plan past a single World Cup. So my question that I was raising for everyone in the blog is, how are we approaching this World Cup any differently to what 2006 was? 2006, we're delighted to be there. Here, we're still hoping and praying to get out of the group. We believe that we can. Nevertheless, what have we learned from the previous three World Cups that we clearly all understand that we're applying? And what are we planning to do for the next two or three World Cups? Because the reality of the World Cup, as everyone knows, is it's not the best 32 nations. I think we're ranked 36 at the moment. So if that's the case, we're not in the World Cup. The World Cup is marvellous because it gives different areas of the world an opportunity to play. It's very important. But it also, by a quirk of geography, puts us in the same bracket as many of the top nations, i.e. we are as close to the likelihood of qualifying as many of the top nations in the world. Look at Chile, just missed out, and all of the South American nations, aside from Billy, from Brazil, have missed out at some point. So in other words, we're in a very rare classification of countries. You pretty much know that you're going to be there. The question is, what can that do to our planning in order to one day be able to win the World Cup?
So when it comes to planning, of course, that seems to be the underlying message here and the theme in the context of the discussion. Where do we need to start, Foz? And I guess when you look back and sift through the sands of time, what have we learned from our last few qualifications?
Yeah, well, we'll know more after this World Cup, but I thought we'd learned about our approach to the game and that we'd committed to a certain approach. But what happens, the big issue for us in Australia is that we rely on much of the football, culture, knowledge, industry from global, from around the world, and people I think are probably less confident yet of really being strong on creating our own
identity, you mean?
Yeah, I'm talking about all of our own planning and being able to stick to it. And the reason is because in world terms, Australia is not a big gun in terms of football, so many people will feel more comfortable if you do things that other nations do. My point is this, that only eight nations have ever won the World Cup. All of them, aside from Uruguay in 30 and 50, have populations well in excess of 40 million. They all have much bigger football industries. They all are pretty much the one sport in that country.
That's right.
We know all the advantages that they have, which are relative disadvantages for us. Put into the case, of course, all of the numerous sports in Australia splitting the talent pool. We've got huge challenges other countries don't have. If we do the same thing and think the same way, the likelihood or reality of us ever winning a World Cup is almost zero. And that's from people who are, you know, the greatest believers in the game. The point is we need to plan differently, and because of our geography, we actually can. So if we were in stronger zones of the world, we actually couldn't. You'd be struggling. You'd have to say, look, we're going to plan over the next 12 years here, and we're going to create our own identity, and we believe this is the way that we should be playing. And we've, you know, and we've had this discussion recently, and now it's the reason why it's important in this World Cup is because now we're in flux. People are going, we're really not sure about that. We lost a few games, and we almost didn't qualify, and all of a sudden, the tendency of almost every other nation in the world, at least 200, is to then throw out the whole plan, because the emotion of almost not qualifying is so intense for them and for us that it's almost natural. But that's because even top-class football nations, I mean, I looked only at our group, aside from others, you know, Denmark have only, I think, been there on four occasions previously, right? You're talking about a team that won the 92 Euros in famous style, the Laudrups. You know, we look at them as a strong football country, but when they're in the qualification confederation that they are, they have to dream about once again making it. We now have been, this is our fourth consecutive time. And my question is, are we still dreaming of making it? The other point is, a lot of people in Australia are saying, okay, well now everyone's getting used to making a World Cup, and so the feeling's not the same.
Expect Australia to make the World Cup.
So, yeah, and many see it as a negative, I guess, because they think, well, the hype isn't the same and so on. I actually see it as a positive, because the issue for Australia is that we need to get over the terror of the 32 years. We need to move into a point where we realise this is number four now, number five in total. There's likely to be a 5, 6, 7. How is it, what are our expectations for this tournament? How is it that we're going to be playing in two tournaments hence? And it's a really rare opportunity that at the moment, I'm pretty sure that we're squandering.
We are in a challenging position in that we saw the departure of Ange Postecoglou after the team qualified for the World Cup. They've brought in interim coach Bert van Marwijk. It's difficult now to ask the question of, especially because we haven't even kicked the ball yet at the tournament, but how much value we can take from this World Cup experience in looking forward to the next one.
Yeah, well, the other point about it is Brazil have been in, this is their 21st, they've been in everyone and they've only won five. Okay, 5 out of 20. So they failed to win 15 times. Now that's Brazil, with over 200 million people who, their football's a religion,
that's right,
as everyone knows. So that means that you're going to lose games in a World Cup. That's obvious. And when you are Australia trying to progress out of, and now our goal is to make the quarterfinals on the steps towards making a final in future, you're going to lose games. That's why my question is, how are we going to lose them and what are we going to learn from the loss? What you see elsewhere...
But how much, Foz, can we really learn from this World Cup, given that we only have a temporary coach?
Well, we can learn a lot. We can learn a lot. We can learn a lot from what happens against France, Denmark and Peru. 100% we can, because we'll learn about our approach. We'll learn about our strengths and weaknesses. We'll learn about where we're broken down. We'll learn about what the patterns are over the last few World Cups. But the thing about it is that most nations come to a World Cup, and now every game, whilst it's important and we're passionate about every 90 minutes, of course, but everything is hanging on it. Whereas for Australia, we can actually step back a little bit and look at it and say, well, hang on a minute, we've been here a few times now, and actually what we should be trying to do is we've learned from the past, we want to try and do this against France, because that didn't work and this didn't work and we're on this path now, let's try that. And gee, that went well or didn't go so well, but we're actually learning from what's happening. And by the next World Cup, we're better. And the next World Cup, we're better. So are we getting better and smarter and more experienced and more consistent World Cup to World Cup? No. At the moment, we're up and down. And we've now changed direction again in this one. That's why I think this World Cup, it's a really important discussion. It's a good time to have it now prior, because once the games start, that's it. All bets are off. All the emotion is on the table and everyone's going completely crazy. And that includes us. So just before the World Cup's a great time to have a look at it. And just be good if fans just reflected and said, you know what, actually, we have an unbelievable opportunity here from a global perspective. What Australia can do and the way we can think about the World Cup and approach it is actually different to almost everyone else.
But the question is, will those learnings, will the lessons out of this World Cup campaign translate to Graham Arnold? And will he adopt them and look to impart that in his role with the Socceroos? Because I guess the biggest question for me out of all of this, Foz, is who is responsible for this lack of strategy?
Well,
and
we
the
all
lack
need
of planning?
To. Well, we all need... There was some planning, but that appears to have been suspended now. And I think that's in large part because we struggled this time to qualify. But you're going to have qualification campaigns where it is more difficult than others. Perhaps Iraq has a marvellous generation when they won the Asian Cup. Perhaps Japan come back extremely strong. Perhaps another country rises up in the next 10 years. It is going to happen. The point about it is not to panic from it, because what I'm arguing is, and what I've seen in 16 years sitting on SBS and now doing multiple World Cups, is that's what most countries do. They have a little bit of difficulty, they panic immediately, and they go through the boom and bust cycle. Take a couple more cycles, another 8 years or 12 years before they get back again. And I'm talking about the mid-tier nations.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden they get back again, and now that's fantastic, but then that may or may not go well, and therefore that might last another 4 years. Then they go change direction again, and they're 20 years away. And then Australia doesn't have to, because we're in a really luxurious position. We never take qualification for granted. That's not the point. It always has to be approached, obviously, in the right manner. Nevertheless, we're one of the strongest in one of the continents on Earth, in which we have the best opportunity to qualify.
So, in essence, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater if things go wrong, and start to plan and get strategic about the future of Australian football.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
Okay, well, that about sums it up. We are starting to get rained on here. It's pretty dismal weather conditions here in Moscow, but it hasn't dampened the fan spirits. As we mentioned at the top earlier, they've really started to ramp up the atmosphere and the excitement here. We're going to go over and say hello. That is it from us in the meantime. Get very excited, because there is a lot coming up on SBS. We've got rehearsals tomorrow. It's all getting underway. But on behalf of myself, Oz, and the entire team at the World Game, it's goodbye, dasvidanya, and until next time.